So he's going to go back and adjust. We did a panic stop. Just because. Camera was rolling outside, so I did a panic stop. And we got a left rear lockup. So Cam's going to go back and adjust the brakes in the middle of the road. Why do we like the guys at National Parts Depot? Because if we're working on the F-100, they're a great source for parts for that particular truck. And a lot of other things as well. Ford, Chevy, Mopar, they have parts for tons of cars. And the cool thing is, they have them in stock. And you can get those parts within 3 to 4 business days anywhere in the United States. Just give them a call 24 hours a day, nearly 7 days a week, and you can have somebody on the line give you the parts that you need to your location. If you don't want to talk to a person online, that's fine too. They have a website that has all the parts listed, and you can buy the parts directly off of the web. They have 4 convenient locations across the United States. They have a location in Ocala, Florida. They have a location in Charlotte, North Carolina. They have another location in Detroit, Michigan, and they have a location in Ventura, California, assuring you on-time, fast delivery of the parts that you need for your car. And the cool thing is those parts are in stock. We like National Parts Depot. We think you should give them a shot. Try them out. They're great folks to deal with. We love working with them. We've worked with them for over 15 years. All right, so brake proportioning valves. We had a guy write in and he wrote, I mean, he was thorough. And I'm not complaining about the thorough because he was kind of right with what he said. He said we should have put the stock proportioning valve in the F-100 when we did it. And in a left-handed way, I agree with him.
It has its merits.
It has its merits. But what we kind of want to go in on this is do a little bit more of a deep dive into what proportioning valves are, what they do, and why it could be important for you to have one or the other on your vehicle. I read some stuff over the last couple of weeks dealing with all this, and one of the things I read was that it doesn't matter how big your calipers are, how big your rotors are, how good your rear bias and front bias is, that the limiting factor of your brakes is always traction.
Yeah, if you can't lock the tires up. Well, if you can lock the tires up with your brakes and skid them, then you're already past the amount of braking force that you can have put to the ground.
And that's really the bottom line on it, is braking force really has as much to do with road surface, road conditions, you know, sand, water, all sorts of things like that, as anything else, and how sticky the tires are that you're putting them down. Because, I mean, let's face it, if it was just as easy as a cut and dried situation, racing would be a completely different fixture these days.
There wouldn't be speed-rated tires, special compound tires. None of that would exist.
Right. I mean, because tires are a big issue in it. I mean, you're looking at the case of, like, we're running S-Series BFGs on the truck. And there's, you know, 235, 75, 15s. So the tires are going to skid.
Because it's also a harder rubber.
The rubber compound is much harder.
It's a road tire. It's not really sticky like a race tire.
A way for you to know what we're talking about is if you buy a set of tires and the first time you're driving them out of the driveway, you hear rocks hitting the underside of your fenders, you've got a good sticky tire and that's going to help with your braking performance. If you have something that's an S-Series tires, the less sticky rubber, you're going to get more mileage out of them, but you're not going to get the braking performance out of the vehicle. Under most conditions, 99% of the time, your braking is going to be just fine with something like an S-Series tire on the vehicle, simply because you're not going in and putting the kind of pressures on the car that a race application
you're
does.
You're not road racing.
You're not road racing your vehicle. Yeah. You're not an F-100. You're probably not road racing it. Okay, so now what we're going to talk about is the elephant in the room, and that is the proportioning valve setup that we have on the F-100. We had a lot of guys write in and ask us why we didn't just do a stock proportioning valve for the truck.
Main reason is the brake lines.
So many brake lines.
Couldn't find the right kit for it. We went through a 3 or 4, and it was all, I think we kept getting power drum front ends.
Yes.
When we needed power disc.
Yeah, and the problem is there's 2 different mounting locations for the proportioning valve.
There's a frame rail mount, and then there's a cross member mount.
Yes.
First set we got was a frame rail mount.
Right.
And then we got, I think, another frame rail mount, but for power drum.
Yes. Luckily, NPD does take returns.
Yes.
Or we would have like $500 in brake lines.
So we just made the easy choice and cut up the brake line that we had.
Well, I mean, here's the thing is sometimes you're going to be in a position where you're going to have to, as Solomon would say, cut the baby in half.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Solomon didn't really cut the baby in half, but you know what I mean. Because we were in a spot where we had already ordered two sets of brake lines. Neither mm-hmm. one of them worked. So we just finally then went and ordered the third set of brake lines, which was the original style that we knew would work.
Yeah. That would get us in the right location for everything that we
Yeah, do. Exactly. So then we just went with the distribution block that we had mm-hmm. from the original truck and put the brake proportioning valve on there. Yeah. All things being equal, I would say that on the truck as we're set up right now, a stock proportioning valve would be a great idea. I'm going to break that off into something else in just a little bit, but what you've got going on is it's not technically a brake proportioning valve.
Mm-hmm.
It is a, I would guess, a brake modulation valve.
Mm-hmm.
So
or hydraulically fancy terms, it'd be a fixed orifice pressure reducing valve. Because all it does is it doesn't change it changes the orifice of the line so that pressure can't flow through it as quickly. So it slows down application.
Right, and that's why that's a better deal. I understand mm-hmm. when the guy that wrote in and did the most explanative part of that, which his post was very long and very detailed, and I really liked reading mm-hmm. it, is that he's saying that that's the way to go because it's a modulation rather than like a ones and zeros setup that you have with the adjustable proportioning valve. Because the adjustable proportioning valve, it is at that spot all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas with the stock style proportioning valve or modulation valve, it will modulate as greater pressure is applied to the brakes, if I understand what I'm reading on proportional valves correctly.
They'll both technically do the same. In hydraulics, you'll have low pressure on the... it's hard to explain. You're going to have low pressure past the orifice until the entire circuit is filled with oil. And then you'll gradually match pressure to before the orifice because it'll keep flowing slowly in. So it'll eventually be equal, and all your brakes will have the same pressure.
Which is what you're looking for.
Yeah.
You don't want a rear bias on the vehicle, because mm-hmm. rear bias is going to cause...
Especially on a truck.
It's yeah. already skatey as yeah. heck anyway. So if you're going to be having anything, you would want a front bias
yes.
on a truck.
Heavy bias.
Yeah, heavy front bias. But even that's bad, because mm-hmm. you can tend to lock up the front yeah. brakes and you have no directional control. Your ideal setup would be to have an equal bias front and rear, which is... in any circumstance, cataclysmically hard to do.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really bad on a truck because you have a situation where you have a very light rear end and a very heavy front end, especially on our truck with the 390 and the 900-pound intake manifold on it. With a very light rear and a very heavy front, rear brakes are always a problem. It was enough of a problem that Ford actually went to ABS
mm-hmm.
sometime in the 90s.
Yeah.
On the rear of the truck. They didn't go ABS until like 99 or 2000, somewhere in there. I think it's 99.
Brick nose and I believe bull nose had rear ABS.
Right.
Front ABS didn't come in until the Easy Bake Ovens, which was 2000. That's what
it's
I call
so, them. So many names for these things now. Like, you need a scorecard to tell you the players on. Because, I mean, you got brick nose,
baseball
bull nose.
Cards for four trucks.
Ooh, he's got an Easy Bake Oven.
Oh, he's got a 351 Windsor.
Look at the stats on that one. But anyway, so that's kind of the thing on that. With the, you know, without ABS,
mm-hmm.
you're really just trying to make the best of a bad situation, which is kind of what we did with using the manual
yeah.
proportioning valve. Race teams spend hours and hours and weeks trying to get their brake proportioning correct on road racing, especially when it involves the brake proportioning, because it has a great deal to do with how well that mm-hmm. car pushes into a corner. You want equal pressure front to rear so that the car actually plants rather than nose diving or heeling, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a lot of rear bias, it's like somebody driving around the track pulling the emergency brake on you every time you push the brakes, because you're just going to lock up the rears and it's going to be a skate. You're
and
not going to
slams the front into the ground.
And it slams the front into the ground, so you're going to still have the same kind of issues. All right, so now what we're going to talk about is why a stock proportioning valve can be an issue in a car or a truck.
Mm-hmm. Basically, if you change the system. We're car guys. We like to upgrade things.
Everything's going to be upgraded.
Yeah. So if we stepped up to a more aggressive brake pad, say like a yellow stuff EDC pad or something, which you get like, I think they claim 20 or 30% more braking force, that's going to change what your bias should be.
And especially if you're only doing the bigger, you know, grabbier pads on the front.
Yeah, front.
And you're not matching that with the shoes in the back. And that's kind of, there's a company out there that does the rear drum setups that are more high performance drums.
But it's much less common to do that.
Yeah, a lot of guys don't go to that trouble. I mean, you know, we may, like say on Logan's Ranchero, we may would go in, do discs up front, and do a set of those bigger drum brakes on the back. Because I actually like drum brakes for street applications. I think that your braking power is a little bit better out of the rear drums on a normal daily driving situation than discs. Discs don't heat up as bad.
Yeah, discs reject heat a lot better, and they're good for repeated braking application.
And that's why you see most of the race teams are out there. They're running disc brakes, you know, carbon fiber stuff, you know, doing all kind of crazy things with them. But on a
street use, drums work fine.
Yeah, and like I said, but that's the problem you run into. You can get pads real easily from a lot of companies
that are super aggressive.
That are very aggressive, going to give you better braking prowess in the front.
Yeah.
But if you've got drums out back still, all bets are off.
And say if we were to do something like put a 8.8 or something in the truck to go disc brakes, then you have to readjust the bias as well, even more so.
Yeah, and I mean, so that's the problem. You run into, so then do you run the proportioning valve from the new truck?
Yeah, well, you'd have to use... I'd probably just use a manual valve.
But what I'm saying is then again, you're how much did Ford cut the baby in half as far as what they were doing? That's the other part of proportioning valves that we're not real sure on that I was wondering about. You and I sat down and talked about this before this morning. If you have a 302 in there on an F100 with a short bed, is the proportioning valve different on that truck than it is on
a big block truck?
Right, a big block truck with a long bed. Or in 78, crew cab.
Yep.
You know, because it's a bigger, heavier truck, the cab weighs more with a big block up front and a C6 as opposed to a 302 with a C4.
Or an inline with a 3 on the
tree. Or an inline with a 3 on the tree, which is going to have a completely different weight bias on the truck. So proportioning valves, I think it, on the blush of it, it makes a lot of sense what the guy was saying. In a stock application, if you can go potatoes to potatoes.
100% stock, proportioning valve from factory works great.
If we've been, if we were doing a 78 and just rebuilding the disc brakes on a 78, we would have gone with a stock proportioning valve. We'd have probably left the one in there that was in there.
Yeah, especially if we could find the brake lines.
Let's not go there. I might have been just more me than anything else.
Possibly.
Because, I mean, you know, there's like 800. I'm going through the NPD site going, wow, that's a lot of brake lines. With a truck, you know, gross vehicle weight of 32 million pounds plus 4302, and it's got to have a 1643 with a 50108. And I'm like,
The trucks run mostly GVRW ratings.
Yeah. And I mean, but even so, you know, you got F350, F250, F100, F150.
Yep.
All right. So, adjustable proportioning valve. Now, what we're going to talk about right now is how to adjust your proportioning valve. Basically, you put this on the back brakes. And what you'll want to do is you'll want to decrease or increase your proportioning so that you're not locking up the back brakes. What you're looking for is equal bias between the front and rear. You want to come to a hard screeching stop. You don't want the back brakes to lock up. On a Ford F100, good luck with that activity if you have a big block in the truck like we do. And it's really just as simple as taking the truck out, driving it repeatedly, going through stops, and starting it up, running it up to speed, showering down on the brakes, seeing what happens. If the back brakes lock up, you go in and you decrease the amount of brake pressure to the back brakes. And you'll just incrementally do that. Usually it's probably about a quarter of a turn for incremental decreases in pressure until you get to a pressure to where both front and rears are doing the same job. Remember, you're going for equal bias, not front bias or back bias. Back bias is bad juju. It makes the truck feel kind of skaty and not planted. So that's what we're looking for. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go out and do a few of those and show you what I'm talking about with making those kinds of adjustments. We have a nice straight stretch of road near the house. I'm going to take the truck over there and see what we get. All right, so he's gonna go back and adjust. We did a panic stop. Camera was rolling outside, so I did a panic stop. And we got a left rear lockup, so Cam's gonna go back and adjust the brakes in the middle of the road. Safety first! All right, so I know we've got a problem somewhere. We've done as much adjustment on the drums as we can do, and we're not getting any more out of it. So we probably will need to go in and work on the backing plates on the truck. But what we're going to do now is we're going to show you what you would do to adjust the proportioning valve if I can get this big pig turned around and not hit pine trees. So Cam's down there waiting on me. He'll go in and pop the hood, and we're just going to do incremental adjustments on the prop valve. The right one's starting to lock up, but not quite yet. Now Cam's going to come in. He's going to adjust the prop valve. And what we're trying to get is no lockup on the rear brakes. So he's going to decrease the amount of fluid going to the rear brakes. I think we're just about where we're going to be. He's going to come in and give it one more shot, though. Doesn't seem to be making any difference. He just increased it going the other way to see if that would help. It didn't make much difference. And again, I think some of that might be because we're talking about a truck and it's really light out back and really heavy up front. It's going to take a lot to get the back brakes to sing well with the fronts in that case, and not, at least in my opinion. I think that no matter what I do, because we're so heavy in the front and light in the back, yeah, both sides aren't grabbing. We've got a little issue here, but what we've shown you is how you would go about adjusting the prop valve on this. Now, this isn't just for trucks. This is for cars also. So what we're going to do is we're going to swing around and get out of the public area because there's a neighbor at the end of this street that could possibly be calling the cops. We're out here doing a legitimate thing. We're adjusting the valve or the brakes, but sometimes people don't really see it that way, you know? All right, Cam, mount up. Well, that was moderately disappointing.
Yes.
But that's what you get for cutting corners.
Yeah, we were trying to get done. We needed to use the truck to haul trash on Monday. So, I mean, our excuse for that is that's the case. I think that it will eventually be better.
Yeah, once both sides start grabbing.
And that's the problem. I mean, under normal braking, where you're not panic stopping, it's actually not too bad. Mm-hmm. We've gone out and checked temperatures on it. So we know that we got a little bit of a temperature issue, yeah. Saying again that we have a braking problem. But man, the thing handles good. I mean, just coming down through the turns here, before this would have been scary at 30 mm-hmm. miles an hour. We're busting along about 40 now.
And it's pretty flat.
That's flat, you know, so I'm real happy with that. Stock proportioning valve, I don't know if that would make a difference or not. The proportioning valve that's on there is not making much of a difference either. That's why Ford went ABS in the yes. future on these trucks.
Because the weight bias in these is absolutely horrible.
And we've got a big block 390. Yeah. I mean, there's just a ton of things fighting this truck.
Really, the way to fix the issue would be to put about 400 pounds of weight in the back just as a counterweight.
Or do an ABS system out of a later model F-150.
Yeah, that'd be the ultimate fix. But then you still have low braking power in the back because you don't have the weight.
Exactly. So, I mean, I think anything you do with an F-100, you're going to have rear-wheel lockup
yeah.
just simply because of what you're dealing with.
Under panic braking conditions, yeah.
This was a car, it'd be probably a little different. Well, that's our show for this week, folks. We're heading back to the shop right now. Do me a favor, leave a comment in the section below. Let us know what you think about what you just saw. Also, check out our Patreon account. We have monthly meetings with our $10 a month patrons, bi-monthly meetings with $5 a month patrons, and it's all a big group. Cam's in there a lot of times. We're looking at bringing on some special guests like Mike Eaton from Eaton Detroit Spring, We've got a couple of other people we're talking to about bringing on board, so please check out Patreon. It's a good way to direct connect with us and also support the show. Another thing I'd like you to do is go out and like or dislike and subscribe. It's up to you, but I really want you to subscribe because, quite frankly, we're shooting for 100,000 subscribers by Christmas of this year. We are now at literally the halfway point of doing that, so we need 40,000 people to find us in the next 6 months, or I'm not going to be able to tell the cameraman that said it's impossible that it was possible. He's still convinced we're not going to make it.
Gotta prove him wrong.
We gotta prove him wrong. He's a kid. Gotta prove the kid wrong. So go out and find people, your grandma, grandpa, whoever you can come up with. Bring them on board and tell them they need to subscribe to the channel, even if they don't watch again. As long as I got the subscribers, I'm happy. And that's our show for this week, folks. I'm not sure what we're going to be coming back with next week. We're off the truck, though. We've done everything I want to do to it for right now, at least on film. We are going to be coming back with the axle redo and doing bearings and stuff on the truck, but that's going to be a little further on down the road. We're trying to get back on the Fairlane to finish up the 4R70W in that vehicle, so that's hopefully going to be coming up next week with that being started again. So, do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on
Autorestomod.
You guys have a great week. See you later. Ooh, squirrel. Always. It's his neighborhood. Or were you saying like there was a car there? We call squirrel for cars,
yeah.
Too. Never know now.
Kenny, you want to be in a film? Kenny, what are you doing?
I'm gonna get the eye of Sauron in a second.
Cat butt, the eye of Sauron.